2022 earnings conference call hosted by Centrum Broking Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Ms. Anvela Carvalho from Centrum Broking. Thank you, and over to you, ma'am.
Thanks, Neera. Good afternoon, everyone. I, Cinderella Carvalho, welcome you all on behalf of Centrum Broking and wishing everyone a very happy Diwali. Today, we are hosting the Q2 FY22 earnings con call of Indoco Remedies. At the outset, I thank the management of Indoco Remedies for giving us this opportunity to host the earnings call. From the management team today, we have with us Ms. Aditi Panandikar, Managing Director, Mr. Sandeep Bambolkar, Joint Managing Director, Mr. Pramod Gholpade, Senior Vice President Finance, Mr. Vilas Nagre, Corporate Affairs and M&A. I now hand over the con call to the management team for their opening remarks. Over to you, management team.
Thank you, Cinderella. Good afternoon, all the participants. Hope you and your family members are all safe and healthy. Let me first begin with the business highlights. Net revenues of the company grew by 15.6% at rupees 373 crore compared to 12.9% at rupees 322 crore for the same quarter last year. In the first half of the year, revenues grew by 27.9% at rupees 754 crore as against rupees 589 crore. EBITDA to net sales for the quarter is at 23.2% at rupees 86.3 crore compared to 18.7% at rupees 60.2 crore. EBITDA to net sales for the first half is 23% at rupees 173 crore compared to 18.5% at rupees 109 crore for the same period last year. PAT to net sales for the quarter is 11.2% at rupees 41.6 crore compared to 7.8% at rupees 25.1 crore. PAT to net sales for the first half is 10.8% at rupees 81.2 crore compared to 7.2% at rupees 42.3 crore. Earnings per share for the quarter is rupees 4.51 compared to rupees 2.72 for the same quarter last year. EPS for the first half is rupees 8.81 compared to rupees 4.59 for the same period last year. Now on the Indian pharma industry, IPM has shown normalcy in sales from June 21. The sales registered for Q2 FY22 is rupees 43,064 crore with a growth of 14.6%. Most of the therapies have shown strong growth. Anti-infectives, gastrointestinals and respiratory segments have shown significant growth. In September 21, the company's rank jumped to 25th from 29th in the IPM with market share of 0.75%. The source is AVAX data. Domestic formulation business. Revenues from domestic formulation business for the quarter grew by 22.3% at rupees 214 crore compared to degrowth of 6.2% at rupees 175 crore same quarter last year. Major therapeutic segments, namely anti-infectives, gastrointestinals, vitamins, minerals, nutrients and ophthalmics, performed well during the quarter. For the first half, revenues grew by 33% at rupees 429 crore as against rupees 322 crore for the same period last year. During the quarter, two new products were launched, namely Renofin Plus tablets, that is paracetamol with diclofenac sodium, under pain analgesic segment, and Noxa cream, the molecule name ozinoxacin 1%. Under derma segment. The total number of new products stands at 4 for the period. Now onto the international formulation business. Revenues from international formulation business registered a growth of 11.6% at rupees 136 crore as against rupees 121 crore same quarter last year. For the first half, revenues grew by 32.8% at rupees 288 crore as against rupees 217 crore. Revenues from reg markets grew by 9.9% at rupees 111 crore as against rupees 101 crore. For the first half, revenues grew by 34.8% at rupees 240 crore as against rupees 178 crore. Revenues from US business for the quarter grew by 10.2% at rupees 48 crore as against rupees 43 crore for the same quarter last year. For the first half, revenues grew by 33.8% at rupees 94 crore as against rupees 70 crore. Revenues from Europe for the quarter grew by 6.3% at rupees 60 crore as against rupees 56 crore for the same quarter. For the first half, revenues grew by 33.5% at rupees 139 crore as against rupees 104 crore for the same period. Revenues from South Africa, Australia, New Zealand for the quarter grew by 114% at rupees 3.8 crore as against rupees 1.8 crore. And for the first half, revenues grew by 91% at rupees 6.8 crore against rupees 3.5 crore. Revenues from emerging markets for the quarter grew by 20.6% at rupees 24 crore as against rupees 20 crore. And for the first half, revenues grew by 23.9% at rupees 48 crore against 39 crore. Revenues from API business degrew during the quarter at 13.6% at rupees 20 crore. For the first half, revenues degrew by 32% at rupees 31 crore as against rupees 45 crore for the same period last year. The degrowth is because of higher captive consumption, which is around 60% of the total API dispatches. Revenue from CRO and analytical services for the quarter grew by 6% at rupees 3.7 crore as against rupees 3.5 crore. For the first half, revenues grew by 26.5% at rupees 6.5 crore as against rupees 5.2 crore. That's all about the business highlights for the second quarter, and I now request the participants to put up their questions. Wishing you and your family a very happy Deepavali. Be safe, be healthy. Thank you all.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on your touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Participants, you may press star and one to ask a question. The first question is from the line of Mr. Aditya Khemka from Incred Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, happy Diwali everyone, and very good afternoon. Thanks for the opportunity. Two questions. Firstly, in the European market, you know, when I see sequentially compared to 1Q to 2Q, we have seen a decline in revenues. What would you attribute that to?
Yeah, Aditya, we have had certain challenges in the dispatches. Container availability is the first challenge. And the second challenge is API material availability. So both these have been looked into very cautiously and very carefully, and we have taken measures to see that things improve from here on.
Right. So are you saying that the dispatches in 2Q were significantly or were lower than what you were expecting, or is it that there is a pricing challenge or a market share challenge? That's what I wanted to understand.
No, there's no pricing challenge. The dispatches were lower than what we were expecting. That's right. Because of the container availability.
Okay. So as a corollary, some of these dispatches would get bunched up into 3Q and 4Q, and we should see recovery of sales because there is no loss of sales because it's just about dispatching.
Correct. Absolutely.
Okay. That's understood. Same question for the US business. So, you know, now at least I would have expected we would have received from some profit share and sales from brinzolamide into our second quarter numbers. But it doesn't seem that there is any meaningful uptick in the US sales for the quarter. So what would you attribute that to?
US order book is very healthy. I don't think there is any reason to be anxious or, to have any sort of that kind of feeling. Very healthy order book, and we will recover in the third and fourth quarter, definitely.
But did we receive any profit share from brinzolamide in the second quarter? Have you recognized any profit share?
Aditya, over two quarters in piecemeal, it has been coming in. Close to around 8.5 has come in as of now. Because this is against what they sell in US, actually, and collect. So it's a long cycle. Yeah?
Understood. Aditi, can I understand the cycle a little better? So when do you recognize the profit share? When they sell and pay you? So is it when you receive it or is it when they sell?
Yes. No, after they collect and then they send us.
Okay, yeah. So it's basically upon receipt you recognize the
profit share. Yes.
Understood. Then I can understand the long cycle. That makes sense. One more question on the India business. So we did 22% growth in the second quarter, and that's obviously a lot of it is because due to recovery of the anti-infective segment coming back in the market. Can you talk a little bit about how the chronic piece of our business, although it's very small, I understand, but the newer products which we have launched on the more specialty side, how are they sort of faring in the marketplace, and you know, how is the progress on that front?
Yeah. So Aditya, as you rightly said, virtually there has been close to 95% growth in anti-infectives alone. Of course, aided by a good season this year and also by an extremely low base last year. So that is correct. So the acute segments, anti-infective and respiratory, both really helped us this quarter. Other than that, if you have also seen the industry data, chronic per se has been muted for various reasons. We ourselves are not don't have chronic as a great area of strength. However, our focus division is doing decently all right. With CND, which is a cardiology division, there have been some concerns. But I would rather speak about the subchronic part of our business, which is of having the ophthal, gynac, and the two dental divisions. So our dental divisions have done decently all right, an 8% growth throughout, with or without COVID, with or without season or whatever, very predictable kind of sales performance. Gynac has begun doing well. The biggest gainer per se in fundamentally quality of business has been the ophthalmic business, because ophthalmology was most impacted in lockdown. And our teams really used this time to build relationships with the end users, the prescribers. We are seeing an excellent upside on the ophthal basket. This is to sum it up. So I would expect more in Q3 and Q4 from subchronic and then chronic. And of course, the approved run, I'm very confident, will continue.
Thanks for that, Aditi ma'am. Sorry, one follow-up on the U.S. How many products now are we selling in U.S.? So Brinzo is obviously one of the older product basket. You know, Rozo Timo, I remember we are already selling.
12 products in total.
12 in total we are already selling.
Yes.
And how many products are we expected to relaunch of the older ophthalmic basket?
3 to 4 more this year.
This year, FY22.
Right.
Understood. And could you quantify the milestone payments received in US this quarter versus what was that in 1Q, the milestone payments?
They are comparable. Pretty much we've been, as I told you in the last call, because there are several products, there are both US and Europe, and there are several research projects being done for customers. So pretty much now we have a good predictability to collections. I have to say Q1 this year was a bit on the higher side. But otherwise, if you look at 5 quarters in running, it is pretty predictable.
And now you must have seen some regularity in dispatches, given that the freight costs have come off and hopefully containers are more freely available.
Yeah, more than freight costs, there has been an issue with availability of containers. So there is a kind of a pushing ahead of sales is happening in all international markets. Mm-hmm. So that is what has impacted us. I'm sure in a couple of quarters that will still.
Okay, so you haven't yet seen the normalization of availability. You are saying even as we speak about October, November, there is still scarcity of containers.
Yeah, whatever we have seen for the month of October also, it continues. Problems continue.
Oh, okay. Okay. Thank you, ma'am. All the best.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you very much. The next question is from the line of Rashmi from Incred Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity and value to everyone. Ma'am, again on India business, what I'm seeing from your brand data, that, you know, with the decline in the COVID cases and with the growth normalizing, we are seeing uptick in the sales of subjects plus cyclopam. You know, the growth is coming back. But at the same time, Cargill plus Pidodent, we are seeing the YOY digit. I mean, I understand that we should see a quarter-on-quarter growth because these products were used as COVID prescription. I mean, COVID prescription for the COVID patients. But why are we seeing the degrowth on YOY basis?
What has happened, as I explained, is dentists and ophthalmologists were two categories which were most impacted during COVID. And while doctors are coming back, I feel per se still footfall and other things are a bit of a pressure.
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt you.
Yes.
Rashmi, may I request you to mute your line from your side, please?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Ma'am, I'm sorry?
Ma'am, go ahead now.
Yeah, okay. So, as I explained, the dental segment for us, we have two divisions. One is Warren Ace and the other is Warren NextGen. Warren NextGen depends on more demand creation, and there we have seen a good movement of products. In Warren Ace, we have got more of the repeat purchase or more of the counter-push kind of products, and there has been some concern of product growth coming back. But surely, there are some competitors doing a little better. The segment per se is not doing well, but there are we are tracking that very closely. But other than maybe a Kidodent or Sensodent KF, couple of products here and there, pretty much if you've seen, most of the legacy brands across most of our divisions are doing exceedingly well.
Okay, ma'am. And what about this therapy wise? Because for the other competitors, we are seeing a pickup in dermatology segment. But we are not seeing that kind of growth coming back in dermatology segment.
Yeah. For us, derma is not a key focus area. We get into dermatology because of age-old products like Clovenji, which we had, and Noxa, which we just launched. But we do not really consider them derma products. They are taken through our acute division only.
Okay.
So, I think when you look at derma for the industry, it is more of cosmeceutical, derma, the new, the moisturizers and all those. We are not into that. Okay?
Understood. And ma'am, again on the US business, $8.5 million is a profit share or profit share plus sales, which is coming from the brinzolamide suspension for first half?
This is not in dollars first and foremost. What I said was in rupee term.
Okay. And, it is 8.5 crores you mentioned.
Profit. Yes. Share of profit against what? They must have completed selling, accounting, etc. So from 2 quarters ago, possibly. Okay?
Okay. But are we seeing any price erosion, in the new product launches that we are doing or, if you are planning to relaunch?
Because we are in niche segments, not for us as much. Of course, the input prices, solvents going up for API and all is a standard thing across the industry. But even that is stabilizing now.
Okay. And ma'am, what about the tax rate guidance? Because last time you all mentioned that, cash tax of 18%. But I think the overall tax rate which I'm seeing for first half is 35%. So if you can explain on that.
Tax. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Rashmi, the tax rate right now is 35%.
For FY22, you are guiding 35%?
No. For this year, it is 35%. From next year, we will go to the new tax regime, which would be 25%.
Okay, but last quarter, you mentioned something about tax of 18%, right, in FY22?
No, not 18%.
No. We have, even last year it was not 18 because we had max credit which we have availed. And this year was going to be 1 year where we will be getting the full impact of tax. And from next year, we'll be able to move to the 25% regime. We are very clear about that.
Okay, from FY23, we will come back to the 25% regime.
Correct.
Okay.
And the last question on gross margins, are we not seeing any sort of high input cost related to, I mean, our gross margins is basically seeing the improvement sequentially.
Yeah. So, the gross margin improvement is also related to the business mix. So if you were to quantify and take out, say, milestones and dossier income and also because India business did so well, so it has got corrected. But as such, there is an increase in input prices directly and indirectly hitting us. Even when the solvent prices are going up for API manufacturing, products which we consume for our own international business, for example. But in up to Q2, it is not significant. But I expect in Q3, there will be some amount of impact.
Okay, ma'am. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Deepan Shankaran Narayan from Crossline PMS. Please go ahead.
Good evening, everyone, and thanks a lot for the opportunity. Aditi ma'am, firstly, wanted to understand this antibiotic diabetic segment in domestic market. So are we seeing aggressive growth in this segment in future? So are we planning to launch good products in this segment?
You mean anti-infectives and diabetology?
Yeah.
Okay. So Indoco has almost 20% plus contribution coming from anti-infectives. And we have some big brands here. We have ATM, which is our azithromycin brand. We have Oxipod, which is a Cefprodoxime brand. And these products are doing exceedingly well. We have always, if you are an acute heavy company, anti-infective is a large part of your portfolio. In anti-infectives, per se, there have not been too many new products coming in. Cefprodoxime and azithromycin are the molecules of choice even today. And we see good demand for these products. In any case, in second quarter, because of season, the demand used to pick up. Now, because of COVID and post-COVID related complications also, the upper respiratory tract related anti-infectives have increased, consumption has increased. So we are doing well there and we expect for this momentum to continue. Coming to anti-diabetics, it is a very small portfolio for a company like Indoco, but potentially a very good one. For the industry, it is one of the fastest growing categories. And simply because there is a large want from the doctor community for new molecules, because they're finding it difficult to bring HbA1cs under control, for example. So there is definitely a want here. So when there is a want, certainly those markets always do well. It's a very competitive market. Indoco is one of the late entrants here. But on account of the product mix which we have for US, where we have gone after several Para 4 kind of opportunities, we have excellent products for launch in India as well. Our Aloja launch, for example, is one which we have done. And in our own fashion, we will create our own place and niche in the diabetology segment.
Okay. So I remember when we were discussing about Alogliptin and some combination products in anti-diabetic segment.
Aloja and Aloja M. Aloja M has also been launched now in the market. We expect this molecule to get good sales. We are the only player in the market.
Okay. And can you provide some guidance for FY23 in our US, Europe and emerging markets?
We are not yet. US is a is on a healthy growth path, and we hope to do well this year. I think maybe by end of Q3 would be a good time to talk of numbers for the future.
Okay. And lastly, domestic segment, are we seeing inventories back to normal levels post COVID now? Are we still seeing inventory at lower levels only?
Inventories of acute are still very much on the lower side. In fact, Q2 consumption was very high in some segments like respiratory, antibiotics, GI. But others, there is a good amount of stabilization. So inventories in the market, if you mean, they're still on the lower side. There is quite a high demand still. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, so Q3, Q4, so post the season going away, still we are expecting good growth in domestic segment for us?
Yes, so we have other products which start doing well. I'm hoping, keeping fingers crossed, for an excellent performance from dental, gynec, ophthal, cardio, diabeto. And even for the acute divisions, other than the very seasonal products, which will also do their bit, we can expect good performance and growth.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am, and all the best.
Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Charulata from Dalal & Broacha. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi. My question pertains to the U.S. There is a 10% growth in Q2. Do you expect new launches in FY22?
Yes. Last year, same quarter, we had a lot of launches, and that's how the growth was huge. But in Q3 and Q4, we will have good amount of launches, 3 to 4 at least.
Okay. And do you see an increase in the profit sharing for Benzo going up? Because I believe there was an exclusivity for Brinzo.
Brinzo, there's no such exclusivity.
Yeah, we were the first generic.
Yes, that's it.
And the exclusivity is created because it was a difficult product nobody could make. It is not an exclusivity created by patent situation or anything like that.
Right, but being a first generic, it would have got good pricing, right?
Yeah. Charulata, whatever advantage we can derive from that, we will do it.
Okay, but has that come in or it is yet to come?
Partly it has come in and it will come in phases.
Okay. So for just confirming that milestone income of 150 million in Q1, the Q2 number also is on similar line?
Yeah.
As Aditi said, it is predictable income.
Okay, so every quarter we can consider 150 million?
Charulata, it depends on which product, milestone for which product gets collected, specifically regular.
Right.
Aditi ma'am, we are not able to hear you. Yes.
So, your statement of can we take it for granted, I said roughly this is how we can expect things to be. Okay?
Okay, fine. Yeah, and my next question is on the India business. How many MRs are you currently having? And do you expect growth to continue in Q3 and Q4 above industry average?
Yeah, so we have around 2,300 medical reps. With managers, it's around 2,800. Your question on will the India business continue to grow? Yes, even today, even if the Q2 highs of the market, IPM is off Q2 kind of highs, overall, slowly the market normalization is happening, and Indoco as such is doing much better than IPM as well as the covered market.
So we will post good growth in India business in Q3 and Q4.
Okay, fine. All the best. Happy Diwali.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abdullah Kardar from Elara Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thank you for the opportunity. Ma'am, my first question is on the US business. Would you like to highlight any particular reason why there would be a slower uptick in brinzolamide for your partner to book sales, and which is also impacting us by, you know, getting this the related profit sharing income getting delayed? So considering we are just
I don't think we are in a position to comment on that, honestly. But the order position is good, so I believe they know what they're doing.
Okay, sure. And just on the guidance front, are we still maintaining our top-line guidance of close to 16.5 billion rupees for the fiscal 22 and EBITDA margins of 19% to 20% for the fiscal?
Yes.
The EBITDA guidance given was 19.75%.
Okay.
We stick to that guidance.
Sure. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, you may press star and one to ask a question. The next question is from the line of Aejas Lakhani from Unify Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, just one question. What is the MR productivity today? Because I remember hearing that you had an aspiration to take it about 3 lakhs. Could you give some color on that?
Currently around 2.6.
Okay, how do you expect to take it to this figure greater than 3?
Because we are not adding any more people. So naturally, all growth that comes in sale is going to go towards increasing the per man return.
Okay.
Also, there are a lot of new product launches planned. That is one area of weakness for Indoco as a company. We have done very well with our first launch this year of Noxa, and there are 3-4 other products in the pipeline. They will also help increase the PHY.
Got it. Okay. And, you know, in the German market, there's been a buyer consolidation. So, does that favorably or disfavorably impact us? Could you comment a little bit about the German market?
Yeah. German market, we are doing well, even now as we talk. One tender we have won, and 2 more products are being planned in a similar fashion. We are the front-ended company, and we have appointed a distribution company to distribute the product all over the country, and we pay them for the distribution costs and some profit.
Okay, and I'm aware about the German tender of roughly 70 crores, you know, which was expected to be the growth driver. But you're talking about 2 more incremental tenders coming in FY 22 or 23?
That will be for 23.
Okay, and would the size of these tenders be equivalent to what we won last year, or?
No, these will be smaller.
Okay, and again, will be 2-year orders.
2-year supply, yeah.
Okay, and we continue to be at roughly 300 crores in terms of guidance in the Europe business, right? For 20.
Yes, yes.
Okay, thanks, Doug.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rashmi from InCred Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity again. Question on API segment, you know, in domestic as well as outside API sales, we are continuously seeing the degrowth from last quarter. Any specific reason for it?
Yeah, Charulata, we are consuming most of the API we are making right now. So the international business growth, priority is being given for internal consumption. I'm hoping in a couple of quarters to be able to correct this cycle so that there will be enough to sell.
Okay. For any guidance in FY22, we will see similar kind of growth what we are seeing in first half, right?
Yeah, around 20% we should be able to do.
Okay. And ma'am, you all have guided operating margin of 19.75% in FY22, right? EBITDA margin?
Yeah.
Correct, yeah.
But don't you think like first half only we have done 22% and the 19.75% is pretty conservative because you said that, you know, we'll be doing good amount of US launches.
Rashmi, from Q1 to Q2, you see the numbers, no? Despite such a robust India performance, investment in R&D has started in a big way. Travel and sales promotions cost attached to India business are coming back.
Cost
of goods, as you have already heard, there is incremental, change. So we prefer to stay with our guidance right now. This is on sales, not total income.
Okay. Got it. And that's it from my side.
Thank you. Participants, you may press star and one to ask a question. The next question is from the line of Rajat Srivastava from InCred Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for taking my question. Ma'am, just a couple of some bookkeeping questions. Number one, your other operating income has come to around 14 crores in this quarter. So there's a sudden bump of, like we were doing around 5 to 6 crores in the previous quarter. May I know what is this attributed to? Why is this a sudden bump?
Yeah, it is purely a Forex related thing on when the orders were booked and at what they got fulfilled. It's not in our control.
All right. And also the depreciation cost has come down by somewhat around 4 crores quarter on quarter. Why is that?
In the first quarter, there was more amortization. That's all. So it's more of a Bookkeeping thing.
All right. And ma'am, for your CAPEX guidance, does it still stand at 80 crores? Because I think in the first half, it's around 56 crores.
Yes. We stick by our CAPEX guidance.
All right. That's it from my side. Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, you may press star and one to ask a question. A reminder to all the participants, you may press star and one to ask the questions. The next question is from the line of Shanti Patel from Shanti Patel Investments. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon. My question is, taking into consideration all the factors, what will be the approximate turnover for the accounting year 21-22? And what will be the PAT margin thereon?
So we are certainly looking at in excess of 1600 crore and with the EBITDA margin of what was your question on PAT or gross margin?
Not gross margin. PAT, PAT margin.
Right. So as you must have seen in Q2, we have done 11.8%. So we should for the whole year be able to do around about 10 to 11%.
10 to 11. Okay. And the next question: what will be the return on capital employed and the return on equity?
Yeah, ROC has finally come in excess of 15 to 16% after a lull of 4 years. We are very happy about that. I expect it only to go up from here. We will be able to do, I think our at the same capex we should be able to deliver at least twice the amount of international sales, so I'm pretty confident going ahead this number will only improve from here.
Madam, you're joint managing director, right?
I'm MD. Yeah,
MD. Okay, what is your qualification?
I'm a pharmacist by profession and a master's in pharmaceutical administration.
Oh,
but my biggest qualification is 28 years of working at
Indoco. Right. No, I can make out the way you are answering the questions. And you've got a good accounting knowledge also.
Thank you. That is not my strength, honestly.
No, but I think, whatever maybe, but reasonably very good knowledge.
Thank you.
I thought there may be a mix of finance and technical and something like that. So that is why.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
The next question is from the line of Vishal Manchanda from Nirmal Bang. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. Could you give a guidance for the US sales this year? So kind of you had a earlier guidance of 250 crores. So does that stand?
Yeah, we stand by it.
Okay, so the run rate should accelerate in subsequent quarters.
Yes, it has.
It has to accelerate.
The order position is excellent. There have been some concerns on logistics, as we explained, with container availability, some related to material availability, but it all gets sorted out soon.
And so would this be driven by your existing portfolio largely, or you are expecting new approvals that are going to drive this number?
Largely existing, as we said, another couple of new product launches, but largely existing.
But most part of it is going to be driven by the existing products.
Yes.
Okay. And just one more on the EBITDA to operating cash flow conversion. What should we expect there for the year?
EBITDA to cash flow generation.
What was your question?
What percentage of EBITDA would get converted into operating cash flow?
Operating cash flow. See, we have said that we will end up with a 19.75% EBITDA totally by the end of the year. And we have said that 80 crore will go into CapEx. So if you remove that.
Okay.
Yeah.
And working capital should remain flat. Is that what we can assume?
Yeah, remain flat. Even the short-term loans are now flattish. They're swinging between 105 and 120 crore short-term loans. So they're well under control.
Got it. Just one more on the domestic side. So AOICD reported growth for the quarter was in excess of 30%. While I think the reported your reported growth is lower. So
yes. So there is always something. There is a small gap between primaries and secondaries. Primaries is what we do internally. Secondary is what gets actually sold in the market. And I already answered this earlier. There has been stock depletion actually in the market for us in anti-infectives and respiratory. Q2 has been about actually running to deliver, because some of the products have done in excess of twice or thrice the amount they had projected. So there is a small gap, but we are very sure there will not be stockouts. And in fact, going ahead, that is very positive for the company. We will be able to sell more.
Got it. Thanks. This is helpful.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Aditya Khemka from Incred Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, ma'am, a couple of questions on the India business strategy again. So we are launching new products in the pain segment, right? You mentioned diclofenac and paracetamol. Large segment, but pretty crowded already with a bunch of incumbent players. You know, when you launch such a product, when you are, let's say, the 20th or the 30th brand to be in the market, how do you...
One correction. This has been launched in our dental division.
The dental division.
No. It is more to, you know, because as we are number one with the dentist in stomatologicals, in with pain and antibiotics, we are not big. And we could see with the $0 of the world, there is an opportunity. So this is more of an opportunistic product. It is not a launch to become big. My bets are more on Noxa, the other launch, which is the Noxa topical cream for impetigo. And there are several products lined up for our acute division coming up. Yeah.
Right. So my question exactly was that I don't know if $0 is prescribed in dental, is it?
Of course it is. Aceclofenac, very big.
Yeah. So my question was that if you are going to compete with a $0, which is an established incumbent, how do you differentiate your brand in such competition?
It is not to compete with $0 as much as to get a co-prescription.
So this will be a co-prescribing product with a $0. Okay, not really competing with it.
Not for $0, with a lot of other products which get prescribed by the dent. That's it.
Right, but your product is diclofenac, right? $0 is ciclofenac.
Yeah, that is aceclofenac, correct.
Understood. Second question, ma'am, on the new hires you had announced, I think, 2 quarters back or the last quarter, I don't remember. But you had done a few hires in the domestic business, right? I mean, some of the fresh talent that you acquired from different pharma companies. How is that team now shaping up? How is the energy in the department internally? Is it now synchronized, harmonized? Or, are you still in sort of finding your own place? These people are finding their own place in the organization. If you can talk a little bit about how the new hiring has evolved in the past.
The restructuring was done primarily to fill a gap of new product launch, identifying molecules early, finding the strategic fit and the whole launch activity and the zeal. Towards that, there is great progress. We have begun well. On the other side, yes, inside the organization, they are settling down. So, but much of the strategies we have earmarked are more for mid to long term. By when I think they are, for the running business and running sales and the secondary opportunity in the market is more driven by the existing sales employees. So we must give them credit for Q1, Q2. Yeah.
That's very fair. Last question on the existing employees, DMRs. What is the current attrition?
Attrition is pretty high. Anything between 25% and 30%. There are some regions which are very bad and some which are very stable. It's a geographical thing.
Would you care to explain a bit more, ma'am?
So if you go to headquarters like Chennai, I think attrition would be in excess of 35%, and that's not just for us, for everyone. It's a regional thing. It is a field where people move rapidly. We have done a lot of work in that area, from induction to recruitment to buddy scheme, referrals. A lot of new things happening. I'm hoping with the performance coming in this year, and especially for the acute divisions, close to 90% of people on target. That is one of the best things that can happen for you towards retention of employees. They earn incentives, they will stay. So this might be a good year for us to correct this.
Yeah, because 25% attrition, what it implies is that half of your MR strength is actually on the bench. Half of them are training and half of them are in notice period, am I right?
Kind of, but industry has operated like that always.
Right. So, other than making sure that they make their incentives, any other retention programs, you touched upon a buddy system, you touched upon, I'm just a bit worried, a growing organization, the retention of talent on the medical representative side tends to be a key performance indicator for the longer term sustainable growth trajectory perspective. So, I'm just a little bit worried as to, while we are experiencing rapid growth.
Aditya, we don't see this really in the established divisions. So the acute divisions, the two dental divisions, the turnover is pretty low. It is mostly in the new small divisions where, a boy cannot do his target and then he leaves. We are working around it. Some changes have been made in recruitment policies, retention policies. They have a high amount of variable earning. And sometimes you have to look at it in the cities. Lot of work being done. I'm confident we will bring this under
control. Right. Continuing on this, but can you talk about a bit more about the policies that you're trying to change? What is it that will improve attrition?
We at Indoco, typically a rep was generally recruited at a starting salary. So mostly a fresher or a 1 year whatever. So now we have started recruiting experienced representatives in the market. Since we are not adding people, there will be possibly an increase in wage bill, but it will be well absorbed with the sales growth as percentage of sales. So so now more concentration on quality of people, return per man, less on how many reps, kind of a thing, rut. And I think post the entire lockdown thing, when people were stuck at home and could not meet doctors and brands still got sold and strategies got executed, there is a good awareness and understanding on how this employee as a resource has to be looked at for India business. We have started within the organization a new cell on SFE or Salesforce effectiveness. I'm confident with that we will be able to improve retention, bring down attrition, and consequently, we'll get more effectiveness.
Are you personally heading that initiative, ma'am?
I'm sorry?
Are you personally heading the FSE initiative?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, personally, as in through a president-level person to whom the cell
okay. is. Understood. Ma'am, what is the regrettable attrition in the MFOs and what is the unregrettable attrition? I mean, do you look at it that way? And if you do, can you tell me some data on that?
I can't hear you clearly. I'm sorry.
My question is, what is the regrettable attrition in the MFOs and what is the unregrettable attrition?
A good question. Yeah, there are some which are unregrettable. Considered how sales promotion employees are classified, there are some who exit because we want them to go. But that is not a very big percentage. I would still want to keep people. A steady team gives you more return. Yeah.
Precisely. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dipali from Samiksha Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So I think most of my questions are already answered. I just wanted to confirm that on Europe we had a guidance of around 300 crore for FY22. Are we still maintaining the guidance? So like, are we expecting the growth that we didn't see in quarter two to come back in the second half?
Yes. Yes. We are maintaining the same guidance.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Suraj Jain, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hi, this is Suraj. Just I want to ask on the borrowings. I can see the financial cost is coming down and going forward, what are your plans for reducing your debt?
Yeah, Suraj, thanks for the question. The first priority will be to pay off the long-term debt. We have a mixed bag of long-term debt. Some is in foreign currency and some in Indian rupees. And the average cost of borrowing stands at around 5.5%. So we will repay the long-term debt. That's the first aim. That is around 132 crores. So that's going to take some time to repay.
And any repayment happened in last quarter?
Sorry?
Any repayment happened in last quarter?
Yes, yes. It's a continuous process. In September 2021, we repaid our two long-term borrowings. One was in British pound and one was in US dollars. So one had been taken for the Patalganga expansion and the other one was for acquiring the plant in Baddi. So those two are totally paid off now. And okay. Our short-term borrowings are swinging between 105 crore to 120 crore.
Okay. Regarding your current capex, as you have already told, it is around 80, and you have already done 58. So remaining will be done by internal?
We maintain 80 crore only for the remaining part of the year. Total is 80 crore capex.
Okay. Do you have any plans for borrowing?
I think in Q2, we repaid around 14 crore. Worth of loans, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
Ma'am, the line for the participant dropped. We move on to the next participant. The next question is from the line of Kunal from Valam India. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. I just have a single question. I wanted to understand, ma'am, for the contracts where you have a fixed pricing towards the end customer, for example, the Europe, the Germany contract. So I wanted to understand, in the next 3 to 4 months, maybe, there would be a rapid increase in the input cost. So would it have a major impact? I mean, I'm sure there would be some impact, but how severe would the impact be on the profitability of these, fixed price contracts where the customer would be, not so much willing to negotiate the price beyond a certain level?
Yeah. I think it's a good question, Kunal. For one thing, we are the front end. So to that extent, currently, we had a fixed price to pay to the distribution company, and majority of the profits remain in Indoco. So if we were the back end, the front end customer was paying us practically nothing. 4-5 years back, we had those kind of supplies. But today, we are in a far, far better position. And I agreed with you, what you said is the input costs are rising.
So we are continuously taking stock of the situation and in what way we can handle this. But we expect from January onwards these costs to neutralize slowly over a period of time. So yes, for 3 to 4 months we have been bearing the brunt.
So sir, for contracts like the Germany tender which we had got, which I'm sure would be a fixed price, so there in such contracts, I mean, how so would there be a big reduction in the margin which would get to earn, because you know the COGS for these would shoot up very rapidly in these sorts of contracts? I mean,
no, there won't be a major impact, but there will be an impact.
Got it, sir. Got it.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir. All the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ms. Indrella Carvalho. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. I just want to hear if we have heard anything from US FDA, since we are hearing a lot of inspections now happening. Any update on any of our facilities that you could share?
No, sadly not yet. We are waiting eagerly.
The next question is, ma'am, how do you see the current domestic acute recovery? What is your sense for us on our basket as well as on the industry? If you can help us with your view, how do you see it going ahead? Next second half, how does it look in your view?
So typically the Indian pharma market seems to be stabilizing now and coming to some kind of predictability of performance, a higher single digit growth across most therapies, some double digit. Coming to us, we had some products which were more severely impacted than most other companies, couple of antibiotics, specifically the ceftriaxone brand, which did very badly last year because everyone was home, everyone was masked up, no upper respiratory tract infection. So specifically our product basket, the Oxipod and Bactoguard, we have two brands. They had a lot of sort of margin to make up, and therefore they've done exceedingly well. We are also very fortunate that we have ATM azithromycin, which in Q1 got the upside of the third wave and in Q2 got the season. And the sort of post-COVID kind of secondary infection treatment option it's considered. So in that manner, anti-infectives for us in our portfolio continue to stay very robust, and I'm therefore very confident that despite covered market, because we have such a high level of contribution coming from antibiotics, we will do well.
And ma'am, on the industry per se, any sense for the second half?
Industry again, the acute segments are doing well. I think chronic is still pretty muted, industry is gradually coming back to like I said, a respectable excess of 6-7% growth per month, which is good. Some months, because the base would be very bad from last year, so we have to keep going back and doing the base corrections. But otherwise, good predictability coming into the industry now for growth.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. We'll take that as the last question. I will now hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Yeah. Thank you all the participants and the organizers for this very fruitful discussion. I wish all of you and your families a very happy Diwali. Stay safe, stay healthy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. On behalf of Centrum Broking Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us. You may now disconnect your lines. Thank you.
Thank you.